On August 5th, 1968, Quaker Sound Studios opened for business at 212 North 12th Street, Philadelphia. The owner, Joe Tarsia, invited a couple of acquaintances to try out his new place. So, writer-producers Kenny Gamble and Leon Huff brought in a rhythm section made of Ronnie Baker, Norman Harris, Earl Young, Bobby Eli, Larry Washington, and Lenny Pakula for a test session. Three songs were recorded: We Don't Need No Music for the Landslides, as well as Ghetto Woman and Rover Rover for Ruth McFadden. After listening to the playbacks, Kenny Gamble simply said, "Sounds great, Joe, we'll use it." And the sound of Philadelphia was born. 5 years later, the very same musicians created disco.
One thing about Philly, when they produced records, it was the string section was always very good, I put it like that. And that's what kind of disco kind of elevated from Chubby Checker's doing the twist to where people kind of grooved along with the strings and the rhythm section playing together, you know. Excuse me just a minute. I want to shine on you guys.
And let me say, Norman Harris, I would say Norman Harris's arrangements really typified the Philadelphia productions, which were more, shall we say, disco-oriented. You know, First Choice, Double Exposure, and Norman Harris's strings were heavily syncopated, you know, to the point of maybe being a little busy, but it kind of worked within a context of disco music, you know. I think most of the bigger records associated with disco at the time were arrangements that were done by Norman Harris.
The thing is, what I've learned from the classical writers was when you combine two or three instruments, they get another sound. Like what we did with the Philly thing, like when we combined the George Shearing sound with the MFSB sound, it was just amazing how it worked out.
Well, the difference between the Philadelphia sound and I would say Motown is Stax, because Motown had in-house musicians. They only played for basically the Motown people. And we played for anybody to come across the door. So we would play anything for anybody, you know, as long as we can get that check. So what we did was, the three of us, basically Norman Harris, Ronald Baker, and myself, was I would say the meat of the whole rhythm section. But what added on to make it really sweet was when we had Vince on Vibes, came in with all the pretty stuff, and Larry Washington on Kungas, and Ron Kersey came in with the funk. He's the funky clavinet player, along with Huff was a melody man. And we had T.J. Tindall, we wanted some hard rock. He could play all the rock and roll. So we had somebody in there that could do basically any type of music, and we were all good friends.
In the early 60s through the 70s, there were really three basic sounds in soul music. We had, I like to call it, being critical, but I like to call Motown sort of like black bubblegum. And I think if you want real soul music, you're talking about Memphis. And when I kiddingly, I refer to Philadelphia as being soul music in a tuxedo. I mean, it was lush strings and horns and big productions, and that's my characterization.
But anyway, it was just the kind of music, I guess, that the people were ready for at that time, with the strings and the heavy backbeats. That's what made it happen.
Okay, we're starting with Stax. Stax was fried chicken, collard greens, chitlins, black-eyed peas, and grits. You know, it was gut bucket down home, blues-oriented R&B in the true sense of the word. Then Motown was an extension of that. What happened was when all the musicians that eventually wound up in Detroit came up from Mississippi and Alabama, etc., they brought their brand of funk up north to Motown. But Motown's sound was, in my opinion anyway, was kind of industrial. You know, industrial sounding, you know, like based on the automobile plants that existed in Detroit at the time. So the sound kind of had an industrial kind of four on the floor kind of feel to it. So what happened later on when it shifted to the sound of Philadelphia, our sound was more or less funk wrapped up in a tuxedo, you know, and chitlins and champagne. You know, the musicians in Philly had a way of playing jazz chords. We use major sevenths, minor sevenths, 11th chords, suspended fourths, a lot of chords that weren't necessarily used in Motown. Motown's music was kind of straight ahead, straight major chords, straight minor chords with no fancy embellishments. In our case, we took those chords and added our own flavor to it, and it kind of made it unique and set apart from Motown. Day,